Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another episode of the Wingsnest. I am one half of your team, Rocco Granato from inlacrosserochester.com, and with me, as usual, is Kevin Neibauer from laxphilly.com. Kevin, how you doing, and how was the holidays?
Holidays were nice and quiet. Kind of laid low on the holidays. The first question is, I'm doing well, thank you. And yeah, holidays, a lot of people have issues with them, so we shoulder on and we make the best of it. But the holidays were good, and I'm glad everybody came through it. All right, because it's a festive time, and let's keep it that way.
Yeah. Well, let's get right into it. We had our first game, and the Wings just fell short after a slow start when they lost to Buffalo 17-15. They had the bye week. Hopefully they got things together. Blaze Reardon came off the IR, and they travel to his hometown, Rochester, New York. He's actually from Fairport, but playing in his backyard. And once again, another slow start, slower than the first game, where they fall down quickly, 5-0 to the Rochester Nighthawks.
Yeah, it was really a bad start. I mean, the little things like catching the ball was a challenge for them. It's almost like they had jet lag. They really, really, really started off slow. They couldn't get anything right. And even Trevor Baptiste was battling a little bit, but that's to be expected when you're going up against Jake Withers. But, yeah. You know, the first 15 minutes of that game, 5-0, it could have been a lot worse. It was not good.
Yeah, it could have been a lot worse. Maybe it should have been a lot worse. What was surprising to me was the play between Jordan Hall, Kyle Matisse. It seemed like those two never played together when they were out on the floor.
Yeah, I caught that too. I'm like, what's wrong with these two? They shouldn't even have to look for the ball. Together so much, and it just the mechanics were bad, and just everything could probably anything that could possibly go wrong did. But resiliency wore out. They battled. They came back. I mean, it was way too little, too late. But,
yeah.
They didn't quit. I'll give them that.
Yeah, but I mean, when you fall down 5-0, I mean, we've talked about this, on air and even at the games. When you fall down by that much to start, you look at the clock and you say, there's plenty of time to come back. They could chip away. But you're looking at having to outscore your opponent 5-0 just to earn a tie at that point, to tie the game up. So you reach the top of the hill. Now you got to continue. And a lot of times, just battling back those 5 goals can still take it out of you, and before you know it, you're down by 5 or 6 again real quick.
Yeah, lacrosse is it's a game of runs, and you never, certainly you never want to give up a 5-goal run, but you never want to start behind the 8-ball, so to speak, down 5 in the opponent's building, and at that point, it's, all right, now what do we do, guys? Like you said, we got to score at least 6 if we're going to win this, and we hope they don't score.
Right.
And that's the other variable in Lauken, that is the other team can't score.
Yeah.
You can't counterpunch. Oh, they scored, we score. That's just not going to get it done.
No.
None of us have an answer on how to prevent that. If we did, we wouldn't be doing this.
No. And the thing is, you look at it, and everybody says, there's they had other things with them. You could say, first it was Rochester's home opener. You had a nice little crowd there because they also acknowledged the 25th anniversary team, the all-time team, which brought back players such as Chris Schiller, Patty O'Toole, John Grant Jr., Mike Hazen, who was the coach, but he was also a player at the time. You had Sid Smith, Cody Jameson, Paul Dawson, Graham Hossick, who are on this year's team. They were part of that, 25-year, yeah, anniversary. Timmy Sudan, Reggie Thorpe. I mean, all these players were part of, you know, the fans' vote of the 25th anniversary team. You know, just to mention, you know, a few of them. So you had
the collection.
Yes, yeah, so you had that as a little bit of more momentum for the crowd. Not to mention, this is going to be the last year. Well, you could say technically the last year of the Rochester Nighthawks, because this franchise, these players, will be moving to Halifax next year, and Rochester will have a whole new team made up of expansion players. So the players that these fans are cheering for right now will most likely be the same players they will be booing this time next year.
What a fickle game it is,
hey? Yeah. So there was a lot of emotion.
I posted the final opening night for the Rochester Nighthawks, and I took some flack over that. One guy said, it's not the final opening night. We're going to have, with this existing franchise, it is. They're moving. You're going to have, you don't even know it's going to be a Rochester Nighthawks. So there are some hurt feelings, and I was curious to see how the crowd was going to react. You know, is it, you know, is the lame duck team? Are we going to come out and say, you know, give these guys some class?
Right.
You know, appreciate everything.
Now, I think they're going to keep the name, because the Pagulas, who now own the team, the daughter was, you know, a Nighthawk fan when she was growing up, you know, and the team was around and everything. And
yeah.
I believe that they're going to keep the name. Colors, I don't know what they're going to, if they're going to pop, maybe still keep the colors. Who knows? That's all, you know, who knows what's going to happen. But they do not have a new floor, because I was there last weekend. So I think it's wait until next year for, you know, for the new floor to be installed there.
So that's one of the most. That was kind of topic of conversation with some of the people. Oh, they're not going to Florida play. They're moving. Let, you know, take care of it at the end of the year. It's not like it's unplayable.
Well, something like that, I think, you know, I don't want to get off topic of the Wings, but I think what should have happened is the Pagulas and Kurt Steyer should have got together somehow, some way, and got a new floor on there. That's what's making me think that maybe the logo might be changing, the colors might be changing. I don't know. You know what I mean? So
yeah, right. So a lot of stuff we don't know about.
Right.
You know.
So who knows? You know what's going to happen. But getting back with the Wings, they fall down early, 5-0, and before you know it, you go into the half and you're down 8-2. Yeah, you go from 5 to 6 goals down, and yeah, things are not looking good. The Rochester fans are extremely happy. They basically controlled the game at this point, and the Wings just couldn't buy a goal between hitting a number of posts in the game, especially in the first half. The number of drops was unbelievable. Just passes sailing over top of the sticks, and you know, just the mistiming of passes, and you know, it was almost like Rochester had the playbook in this game for what was going to happen. But the one thing that I thought was going to turn this around, you know, Rochester comes out, they open up 9-2, 9-3. Before you know it, you're at 10-3. And now the Wings start to pepper Agnes Goodleaf. We get to Chris Cluche scoring at 14:59 to bring it to 11-5, okay, at the end of the third. Okay, down by 6, you know, still probably next to impossible. But the Wings score 2 quick goals within the first 2.5 minutes to get it to a 4-goal game. And you're thinking, hey, 4 goals, 12 more minutes, this is possible, especially with the way that they were playing. But the killer out there, Corey Vitterelli, just scored, you know, right away at 7:56, and then Josh Currier comes back to bring it back to 4 goals. But after that, for the next 4 minutes, post after crossbar after post, we hit, and it just wasn't going in.
And, you know, the shot selection left on the be desired. To you were at the game. I don't know how many times Goodleaf got hit the logo with a shot.
Well, they kept everybody to the outside.
Yes, they did. It was a great defensive performance for Rochester, because no matter what they did, as creative as Reardon and Rambo, I mean, they took Rambo out of the game. You keep him to the side like that, he's neutralized. And the one thing I wanted to bring up, Buchan was in, he got run over. The guy scored. I think it was Jameson. Jameson scores, he runs him over. Referee immediately calls it a goal, and I'm like, come on, it's goaltender interference. They review it and overturn it, and then they give him the penalty. So I'm like, wait a minute, how does this play out? You didn't see, you're 10 feet away from him, you couldn't see that the goalie got interfered with. You can't touch the goalie in the crease.
Right, well, no, he did get a penalty, and the goal was wiped off.
Yes, it was, but I mean, my point is, originally it was called a goal.
Right.
And then they reviewed it. I don't know, you had there, but it was a review, they reviewed it.
Right. Well, as we know, the rule now in the league is if you make any contact with the goalie when you're diving across the crease, it's automatically goaltender interference. Unless, and this is a big unless, you know how the goalies like to take that little step forward and lean into it?
Mm-hmm.
That's where they would say it's not goaltender interference. Because if the player is already in midair, okay, let's say he's maybe 2 feet in on the crease and when he dives, okay? And the goalie takes like a step and a half forward while he's already in midair. The player can't avoid it.
Right.
That's where it would not be goaltender interference. Because that would be, the goaltender trying to draw a penalty by doing that. You could see him going into it. So that's why they were reviewing it. Buchan was moving across. He started to move. They wanted to make sure he stayed on that straight line, that he didn't kind of go out on an angle to try to draw that penalty.
So in a long way, I mean, it was the right call.
It was the right call, yes. Oh, no. The fans in Rochester were livid. I had them screaming behind me. That was a goal. So he ran into a goal. And I'm like, you obviously did not read the new rule.
No.
Any contact with the goaltender is goaltender interference. Goal will be wiped off unless the goalie leans into it. You know how Cosmo used to do that a lot.
Right, yeah, Cosmo was famous for that.
Right, so the Cosmo rule is in effect, I'll say. So unless they lean forward or lean into it, that's the only way it wouldn't be wiped off, and that's what they were reviewing. But yes, Austin Shanks did get a penalty for that at 3:24 of the fourth.
Okay, with Shanks. And another, while you're on the rules here, I want to just bounce something around. The Buffalo game last week, this is not Wings, but it was noticed that Mitch Disnew was playing, and the guy's telling me he's supposed to be suspended. I said, for what? He said he had that point. I said, no, you don't know. That is the most misunderstood rule in the book. That's not an automatic suspension. It's a referee discretion. The referee didn't suspend either one of them. Now, as an umpire yourself, you have that incident report, and that goes on that.
Right.
I said, no, everybody seems to think it's a point. It's a game misconduct. It's a next game. It doesn't work that way. So, just while we're on the rules, I wanted to jump that in there.
Yeah. But, yeah, so that, a lot of people were kind of trying to figure out why. Well, that's the new rule now, because too many goalies are getting hurt and things of that nature, that's going on. But then, they scored the empty netter, then Brett Hickey scores, final was 13-9. But what I want to talk about right now is that empty net goal by Cody Jameson, okay? First, let me start off by saying I don't care who the player is, if it was a Philadelphia Wings player, Toronto Rock player, maybe my favorite player that did this, I would be saying the same exact thing. It was very, very unsportsmanlike. Now, granted,
I agree 100%. And
now wait a minute.
Jameson had gone on Twitter defending that.
Yeah, saying, well, let me finish.
I posted back to him. I'm not a Rochester Nighthawk, but if that's me, I'm rolling that ball in the corner, running the clock off. You have the game.
Right. Let me finish. Okay. Now, granted, when you step between the pipes, you're doing it at your own risk, okay? You know, goalies have all the pads, and, you know, if you're running back trying to, you know, save off a goal, okay, I can understand it. But you had 2.5 minutes to go. This is one of the most talented players in the league with the ball. You knew he was trying to send a statement, because I think maybe something between him and Chet Kinesny happened during the game. Because if you take note, he looked to make sure that the goalie was nowhere near him. And if you watch him, he took like a two-step hop, like to get a little extra momentum on it. Like he didn't just stop dead and fire. He took like that little hop step and fired it. Okay? This is a player who could have, from that point where he released the ball, threw it behind his back and it would have went in. Okay? There was no need to fire it, especially right over his shoulder. He had the whole other side of the net to go at. Or he could have went behind his back. Or he still had about 27 seconds on the shot clock. Because the ball was still, you know, it was a quick outlet pass. Okay? He could have ran 30 seconds off or whatever. Okay? And brought it down to 2 minutes. And, you know, the score would have still been, you know, 12-8 at the time. And there would have been 2 minutes to go with the Wings down by 4. But what he did there, I lost a whole lot of respect for him. And, you know, I said this, that this could be locker room material. But granted, they have 4 games before then. But no doubt in my mind that some of these players will remember this. And if they don't, I know the fans will, and the fans will remind them. And I will continue to bring this up until that game is played. Because I do believe that there will be some kind of payback.
Yeah, that's one of the things I said. If you had a Jeff Snyder or even a Bill O'Brien on the bench, does he do that? I don't think he does.
No.
I don't think they have anybody on that team that, you know, they put fear into an opponent's heart as far as, I do this, I'm going to pay for it. You know, maybe Rambo, but I'm, you know what I mean? Like, you had a Jeff Snyder, that's not going to happen.
Well, no. See, the thing is, now in this league, it won't happen at that time, because if something like that happens, you're going to have a game or two suspension, because that put the Rochester Nighthawks up by 5 with 2.5 minutes to go. So the officials would automatically see that this was a retaliatory response, and there would be suspensions handed down. So this would be something that would be held till the next time they play, where you line Cody Jamison up and you give him a hard hit. Maybe you
definitely, I agree with you 100%.
Maybe you get a 2-minute boarding penalty. You know, or maybe you wait until, you know, maybe if you have a, you know, a nice little lead, okay, you lay him out or something. You know, you deliver a nice hard hit. You know, and then, you know, when you have the empty net on them, if one of their guys comes up, you can either return the favor or be more man than them and roll it into the corner. Because you and I know that if the roles were reversed and Philly did that, you know what the outcry would have been out on social media?
Oh, it would have been a nightmare.
Exactly. Typical Philly. Philly. All they had to do was roll the ball. All they had to do was do this or do that. Did they have to fire it? Just like throwing snowballs at Santa Claus, you know, all that would start coming back up again.
Yep.
You know, so, granted, like I said, when you're playing this game and you run into the net, whether you're the goaltender or a defensive player, you run the risk. But there's that unwritten rule that there's no reason to fire the ball the way he did.
No.
None at all.
And you were saying, and the key way you just said it, the unwritten rule, there's certain ways you conduct yourself on that floor. Okay? It's not written down on paper. It's just that gentlemen understand it. That's why you don't do that. You know, it's like the players in hockey. They have a code that they live by. You know, it's not written down, but, you know, you never pick a fight with a guy who's a superstar for the other team. And so, what happens if he hits the guy with the ball? It's going to be an injury.
Exactly.
Yeah. That was his only problem. I don't really believe he was trying to score. I think he was trying to scare somebody.
Well, that's probably something else was going on during that game, And, I mean, when he fired it, he went over his shoulder.
Oh, he put everything he had into that.
Yeah.
I mean, he was on the edge of the crease. I mean, come on.
Close to it. It wasn't right on the edge. He was a couple feet before it.
Yeah, still. It was still,
yeah. And like I said, here's the kicker of it all. When he had the ball and he was running down the floor, with his accuracy, he could have shot it from where he was and it would have went in.
Before, but actually, I thought he looked over to see where Buckin was, and I thought Denny was going to shoot. You know, why not? He's not going to, you know, he's catching up to me.
Right, yeah, he was going to get in the net in time.
And he just kept going with it.
Yeah, and he could have thrown it at any time, but he waited for for Chet to get into the net.
Yeah.
That's what the big problem there was. You know, like I said, you run the risk when you get in there, but that's kind of falls under the unwritten rule. You know, and I've heard people from Rochester saying, well, it's part of the game, it's part of this, it's part of that. But I'll go back and say it again. If we did that, you know how much flack there would have been.
I would never hear the end of it.
Exactly. So I don't want to hear anything. I'm just going to finish it by saying, like I said before, you run the risk when you step in between the pipes. But something like that, that would be like Wayne Gretzky or Mario Lemieux or Eric Lindros taking a shot on an empty net when there's just a defender standing there. Okay? You're not going to wind up and blast a 100-mile-an-hour slap shot at the guy. Okay? When you're already up by two. Okay? You do a wrist shot or whatever. Okay, you do something. I mean, you're not going to blast it from 10 feet away. Yeah,
it's no, just, not at all. Like you said, just everything about that was wrong.
Was wrong, completely wrong. But
I've been able to hear the conversations that were going on after that, while that was going on, and what happened afterward. Did anybody? I'm sure somebody was chirping from the bench.
Oh,
what good is that? You're chirping. Big deal.
Yeah. Well, there was a lot of finger pointing. And like I said, you really couldn't do anything at that point in time because you'd be looking at suspensions.
Yeah, it would have made an ugly situation even uglier.
Uglier, right.
Because that's one of them. You know, sometimes you just got to say, you know what, we'll live to fight another day. Well, yeah, he's got to play in our building, too.
That's right.
Type thing. Yeah. And whether or not they're doing that, I can't believe that somebody isn't going with Russell. Opening face-off, there's plenty of opportunity. Like you said, one team goes up three or four goals. Now I'm going to address that.
Yeah.
I think
that's what they're going to do. I mean, I don't know. I'm not in their office. I don't know. But if it was me, that's just what I would do. That's just what I would do. I would get somebody to line him up, whether it be Frankie Brown or somebody or Chet, somebody, and just line him up. Yeah, and you also got to realize you're going to have to deal with Paul Dawson at that point in time, too.
Yeah, that's the other variable, you know, because Dawson's not going to sit there and watch it.
No.
He's coming at you.
But if the Wings listen to this, I'm going to put this out there. There's a guy that stands about 6'3", 6'4", that lives out in Syracuse, New York, that he has his own little podcast, or I shouldn't say little podcast. His name's Bill O'Brien. Give him a call. Give him a jersey. Put him in for the game.
Hey, you know what, Brock? I mentioned that when I said you're half Nimmer Snyder. But you know, I was thinking that when that happened. You know what? You know, Thrill's out there. And you bring him in just for one purpose.
Well, I trust that.
I mean, the kid can play. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. But he's not going to tolerate that kind of garbage.
No, but I wouldn't put him in just for that, because then that's where you look at a suspension and things like that.
Yeah.
He's a type of player. I mean, granted, a lot of teams are going with defenders who can score. Okay, that's what he said. That's why Buffalo let him go. Okay, because they got defenders who can run the ball and put the ball in the net. My thing is, right now, you need another solid defender out there to guard the front of that net. When anybody comes in the middle, you need somebody out there that's going to, you know, make somebody, I guess you could say, pay for them taking a step towards the crease. Okay? Legally. Not, you know, taking any kind of cheap shots. And Bill O'Brien is the type of player that will lay the lumber on somebody if they try to come anywhere near his area. And that's the kind of defender I think they need. They have some defensemen, but they don't have anybody of that size and that strength. Okay, they need a player like that, or like a Jeff Snyder who can, you know, lay the lumber down on somebody. That's what they need to do.
And Rochester's got one on the room with Dawson.
Right.
And the non-schooling defenseman, it's not unique. It's just it's not the flavor of the month, I guess, is what I'm looking for.
Right.
They want the ball at the show. But Brett Manny made a career off of being a defenseman.
Right.
Paul Dawson's another one.
Right.
Why not? Yeah, bring in this team right now. They need an anchor. Bill O'Brien's the type of guy, if you're not doing your job, he's going to get in your face.
Yeah.
You know, locker room, on the bench, whatever. If he doesn't feel doing the job, that's what they need. They need, like the Eagles always had that one tough guy on defense. He'd tell you like it is. And that's, I think they kind of need that. Right now, they're a team that's looking for leadership. You have a lot of guys who are considered leaders. Are they doing it? I don't know. I'm not in that locker room.
Yeah, that's something that they need. They need an enforcer type, but not somebody who's always going to, drop the gloves or anything like that. But they need some kind of defender that will, somebody takes a step towards the middle, push him right out. And he can push him out with the best of them. Like you said, you brought up Brett Manning. He's the same type. That's what you need. You need somebody like that right now. Okay, granted, you have Frankie Brown who could play that role, but you need somebody another step up from that.
Right. I mean, Frankie Brown, he said, I don't know if he's got that, I'm going a bit dark, it's to a dark side to him, and all of a sudden he turns it the other way and you're going to pay for that hit. I don't know if Frankie does that. He's got the size.
Right.
Every now and then you get surprised, and you wouldn't follow sports as long as I have. All of a sudden, now this guy's dropping the gloves, and he takes care of business. Like, wow, I never knew he could do that. And Billy McGloon's a perfect example of that. When he was still playing, he got sucker punched against Boston. He handled it.
Yeah.
The guy wouldn't take his helmet off. And everybody in the room might say, Billy McGloon? So it happens. I think there is a glaring need to shore up the defensive line back there. I'm not saying the guys aren't good. I don't know how physical they are. If they're physical enough for the way the game is being played.
Yeah, so there needs to be something. I know that the game is, being played differently now, but you need to get somebody back there. Somebody on that back line, because right now too many players are getting towards the inside, and and scoring too many goals. Because both our goaltenders, they play terrible in the first half, but when they come in the relief of each other, they play good. So I mean, I just don't understand it. And I like DeRuccio. I like how he play. He's coming back off that hamstring injury, because when I talked to him, it wasn't his knee, it was his hamstring that popped. He's a young goaltender. He needs more time. Doug Buchan, he went 8-1 with Peterborough, but those nets are 3 inches shorter on each side. They're not, I think it's what, 4x9 for the NLL? They're 4x6s in the MSL. So you're looking at an extra 3 inches, and it makes a world of difference out there.
With the way these slippers can pick corners.
Right. So, I mean, it's, I think that there should be somebody else out there that they can get. Maybe like a Ty Bellinger if he's available. I know he had some rough starts, before, but they need to get, I think, a seasoned veteran out there right now. And granted, DeRuccio is what you would call a veteran, but he's not that seasoned, so to speak.
That's when last season, when he played 11 seconds
31 31 to be exact.
The thing is, the conundrum now, who is available fills that need. I'd like to have a Matt Vince come in, but
what's what I'm saying? I don't know if Ty Bellinger is available. If he's out there, I don't know what goalies are are signed or not. That's the whole.
Yeah, I don't have that either. I'm following the AAL, and there's only a handful of guys in that league that could come in, but they're equivalent to DeRussia. They have a lot of potential, but they don't have game experience. And AAL, it's a good league, but it's not the AAL.
No,
and like you said, Ballinger might be the only one available.
Yeah,
if he's even available. We don't know.
According to NLL.com, I'm looking at the players in alphabetical order. I don't see Bellinger's name on here. I see Garrett Billings on here, and he just signed. So, tells me that this is somewhat in. You know, it's there. So Bellinger is not on here.
Something else I'll have to play Rocker too, and the NLL is unique from other leagues in the fact that it's basically a part-time job. And look at Aaron Bolt, lives and works at Edmonton. He's not going to come east. And he showed that. He signed in Vancouver to stay close to home.
Yeah.
And the teams don't have the budget to continually fly in on Tuesday for practice and then fly you back in for the game. The teams don't have the funds for that. So you're really restricted in locality. You know? But Philadelphia being on the East Coast, and how many teams are in Toronto, Montreal, and you know, eastern portion of Canada, so there should be somebody available.
Yeah. Somebody should be out there, but who knows? I mean...
Yeah, well, that's why they pay Paul Bay.
It's, you know... I think...
Someone will win.
Yeah.
Activate Chris Collins. Give him a shot.
Yeah. Well, speaking of Chris Collins, I was going to bring this up, but good segue into it. I want to congratulate him and his wife, Emily, on the birth of their brand new baby daughter.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up because I'm planning on doing the same thing at some point, waiting for an opportunity. I guess I segued myself there.
January 2nd.
I had it on social media yesterday. I've been holding the baby. So
January 2nd, 4:14 p.m., 6 pounds, 1 ounce. The baby's name is Victoria Drew Collins. You and I both know Chris very well. One of the assistant coaches at Drexel. And one of the classiest guys you'd ever want to talk to. And like I said, I had the honor of talking to his wife and his family after the first Wings game back on December 15th. And her due date was January 3rd. So she went a day early.
Yeah, that's unusual.
Yeah.
Actually, I guess.
But yeah, I mean...
one thing with Curso, talk about a gentleman, that's him. I've never seen a guy in a bad mood. He's always smiling. He's always had a kind word.
Yep.
And we were at some Drexel games, and they really got pounded. And post game, he'll say, "Yeah, tough game. Who do you want?" You know, he just says, "It's business as usual with Chris."
I mean, there's a time to be upset with it, and you know, he handles it the way he's supposed to. But if you look at the picture of him on social media, on his Twitter account. The guy's smiling from ear to ear, and why wouldn't you? You know, the birth of your first child, and kudos to him for wearing a Wings hoodie at the same time.
Yeah, that's what I call it. He's wearing a Wings hoodie.
That's
a really nice pair. You're good for him. You're good people. I never met his wife, but I got nothing but good words to say about Chris.
Yeah, I mean, she's great. Yeah, I spoke to her for a little bit. You know, and jokingly at the game, she said the same thing. She goes, "I want this baby on December 31st, tax reasons."
Yeah, I remember saying that. As I was saying, I'm going to have daddy's little tax write-off.
Yeah, but they got...
Yeah, you said, "I don't have that kind of luck."
Yeah, so a brand new baby girl for Chris and his wife. Not sure if he's going to be at the game tonight. Probably not.
Yeah, it's a...
So...
Part thing to figure out. I don't.
No, I don't think he'll be there tonight.
The way things are going, I don't, I'm going to activate him for a game. See what happens. You see him as much as I do. The guy is in shape.
Yeah, maybe he gets activated for next week. Because I mean, the baby, his daughter was just born 2 days ago. So chances are, his wife's coming home today. And he's going to be at home.
I don't see him traveling up or whatever. He's not even active. He's going to go up and sit there and do that at home.
Yeah. So I think he might get activated for the 12th. Who knows? It'd be something different. I don't know. But, you know, we're just going to have to see. This team, you know, like we said, they can't get off to a slow start, and let's look at who they're playing this week, okay? They're going up against the Toronto Rock, a team that the old Philadelphia Wings always had problems winning, you know, up in Toronto. You know, the last big win I remember up there was the 2001 championship game, okay? That was, I think, only their second or third win ever against Toronto up there, yeah, since they were called the Rock. Since then, I mean, they probably won a few games up there, but their record in Toronto is not very good. So now, new franchise, who knows? Maybe can turn around, but I can tell you this much. You cannot even risk starting out slow against this team. Rob Hell, your last game, figured in on 10 out of the 11 goals that Toronto had. He had like five goals, five assists.
The problem with Toronto is, like, say to you, he stops Scott, you're good. But who do you key on with Toronto? You stop Schreiber, then Hellier steps up. You stop Hellier and Schreiber steps up. Then you got Adam Jones in the mix.
Right.
I mean, they're just a dynamo offensively.
And defense, they're no slouch backer either, especially with Nick Rose. Now, if you can get to Nick Rose early, you could have a shot. But, yeah, you're looking at Adam Jones, Tom Schreiber, Rob Hellier. Okay, we got Brett Hickey. Okay, they got to get on the board. Chris Couche, it's another one. You know, you got to get these Matt Rambo. We have firepower as well. But we can't fall behind early. We can't afford another slow start. You can't, you know, I mean, they lose this game, you're looking at 0-3. Okay, then you come home for, I think, five out of the next six are at home. Because
the first one is Georgia.
Right, and that's, you know, with Lyle Thompson.
Yeah,
and then after that, I think the 19th, they're on the road somewhere, I think, on the 19th.
Let's see where I'm at here. 12th is Georgia. The 19th are at Buffalo.
At Buffalo. And then after that, they're home up until March 8th.
Yeah, they have January 28th, they have Toronto. February 1st, Rochester. February 8th, Colorado. And they follow it up with New England on February 18th. But then when they go on the road, Rocco, they only go to New England for one game and they're home again.
Home again, right.
Against Buffalo. This is one nasty schedule.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's like that throughout the whole league, but the thing is, they got, what is it, five out of the next six at home?
Yes.
Okay, they got a lot of home cooking, okay, early. So they need to get those wins at home. They need to get those wins at home.
I think, you know, tonight it's such an uphill battle, but I think this is as close as you want to get to a muscle-winning game. And you come back in here with some momentum. You beat a high-powered offense in Toronto. You come back home with some momentum. You're going to have the home crowd behind you screaming. And you got to deal with Lyle Thompson. But I'd rather deal with Lyle Thompson when I got some momentum.
Yeah.
And being 0-3, saying, you know, please, Lyle, only score five. You know, to me, it's crucial tonight. And like you said, they got to win these home games.
Yeah. I mean, it's not so much crucial. It's the matter of not starting off slow. That's the thing.
I agree. I mean, you can lose. Wings can lose this game, but I want to see how they play. You know, if they lose a tight one, so be it.
Yeah.
But if they're starting out 5-0 or even 3-0, and that's a major uphill battle. And the other part of that is the Buffalo game, and they were down 3-0, they battled back to get it tied, and that's where you need your goalie to make that save, to keep that momentum, and Buchan didn't do it.
No.
You know, Dallas Elliott did that time and time again. He, you know, he would be so-so, and then all of a sudden, when you needed him, he made that save to keep you on that run. And that's what they needed to do. One will get you two will get you three, then three will get you confident. Yeah, so, you know, that's where it looks. You got to make that save, and this is as
Yeah, it's really big. You know, going against this Toronto team, it's going to be tough, especially up there. I mean, Toronto right now is sitting at 1-1. Here's the thing. They've scored 28 goals. They let up 24. For the Wings, they've scored 24, let up 30. So the scoring is somewhat similar. When you look at the, you know, at the stats, because they both played two games right now. So the scoring seems, you know, it's right there. But, you know, with the slow start that they've had, this is the type of game that, you know, I'm pretty sure, you know, no team takes each other lightly. Okay? But when you see a team that starts out slow against Buffalo and then against New England, against Rochester, letting up 5 in the first quarter and down by 6 at the half, 8-2, some of these players like Schreiber, Hellier, Adam Jones have got to be licking their lips saying, hey, we could have a field day here, guys.
Yeah, and the other side of that coin is they could come in this league, though. I tend to just discount this, but maybe take Philadelphia a little lightly, like, oh, we got this one. Because Toronto, as you know, they have a history of just, you know, you play in a game, well, what are they doing? Yeah. You know, they're shooting balls from Mississauga.
Yeah.
They're way out there. They're transitioning. When their transition game is on, they're probably the best in the business. But Toronto has a lot of brain cramps.
Yeah.
So you don't really know what Toronto team is going to show up.
No. And next week, I mean, you don't want to look ahead, but next week they're in Colorado. So they don't have an easy game next week. They travel out west.
In Colorado, they play this weekend too, but they're not going to be in a good mood. No. You know, they lost their opener and less than stellar performance. They didn't look too good at all.
Exactly. So, I mean,
see, they got Calgary today, so, or this weekend, so that's a big game for them.
Yeah. But so this game is like really up in the air. When Gary and I did our show last night, as much as I want to say the Wings are going to win this game, I think Toronto's going to pull this out. I really do. It's going to be close. I'm hoping it's close. But, you know, if I'm talking, we'll say, in the middle of it all, I would have to say, you know, just by looking at the lineup, I would think Toronto pulls this one out. But I'm not saying I'm not going to be sitting here at home cheering on the Wings. You know?
And the touch on you were saying about Wings have
firepower. Prove me wrong.
And, of course, Toronto does. The biggest difference is cohesion and experience. Other than Matisse and I forgot his name now. It's from Georgia. We played here before. I'm going blank. Other than those two, they played together. Other than that, this is a mix and match situation.
Yeah.
You know, you throw Blaze Reardon in the lineup, he looked pretty good.
Yeah.
But he also looked raw. I mean, he doesn't know these guys, and it's no knock on the Wings at all. It's just they've had no time together. You had that work stoppage, so you couldn't practice officially, you know. The Toronto, they basically had the same lineup for 3-4 years now. I think the key to it, I don't see Philadelphia winning it, but the key to it is you've got to put pressure on Nick Rose early.
Yeah.
Make him move side to side and get in his head.
Yeah.
And if I got to run, I'll run the crease if I have to, just to get him off his game.
Off his game, right.
And I'll take a crease violation or I'll bang into him. Because I think he can, you know, kind of lose focus a little bit. He starts off slow. It's like anything else. We all do it. The harder you try, the worse it gets.
Worse it gets, right. I mean, if they can do that, if they can get him off his game a little bit, you know, and just not, if they just don't start out slow. That's the thing. You know, if they hang with this team in the beginning, I think they'll be golden. I really do. But the only thing that has me worried is how they played last week against Rochester with that slow start, 2 weeks in a row with that, and the uncertainty of the goaltending. You know, the first game, Doug Buchan didn't play all that great. DeRuccio came in, and then they almost pulled it out. So you start DeRuccio in game two. He doesn't do all that great. Malkin comes in, he does better than what DiRusso did. So now you're at game three. Who do you go with? Who do you go with?
That's a tough call. And do we start the game the second half and then put somebody in? Because that's them when they show up.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know if they're snake bit, they're not used to the system, they're bigger than that, or you know, you start off slow, but you know, that's what you got to play the game that's in front of you.
Yeah, well, DiRusso's used to the bigger nets. He's used to it.
Yes.
So I mean, I would tend to lean towards DiRusso in this game. You know, he knows a little bit more about Toronto, obviously. You know, playing against him enough times. But I mean, I don't know. Right now, you know, it's like that's the one thing that's making me lean towards Toronto winning this game. If I'm speaking, you know, fairly down, you know, down the line, what do I actually think? You know, my heart, you know, I'm a diehard Wings fan. I'm going to say no. I want to see the Wings go 18-0. You know, so right now it looks like we can, you know, hopefully 16-2. I know that ain't going to happen either.
you're a Wings fan, but you're also a realist, as am I.
Exactly.
You know, the reality of the matter is there's a questioning goal. And if anybody's new in the Wings system is listening, we're not ripping on your guys. We're just pointing out the obvious.
Yeah.
One of these two guys has got to step up and take charge. You cannot continue to fall behind against the quality teams in this league and expect to come back. It's just not going to happen. You got to come out tonight, Pepper Rose. I don't, you know, shoot from the parking lot on Nick Rose. Just get him moving, get him side to side, get his head, get a little rhythm going. You know, get the first one or two goals, and then maybe the goaltender is going to play with some more confidence because he's got a lead. And you know, you always seem to play bitter when you got a lead.
Yeah.
Instead of saying, "Oh no, here we go again," and it's a drudgery. You get that lead, it's a whole different environment for an infant team. It's basically an infant team. Yeah, they have a lot of experience individually, but not as a team. And the adversity is just going to snowball. They got to stop it now.
Yeah, it's something that really needs to be done. I mean, they got to do something this week. Because like you said, next week, you're looking at Georgia coming into town with Lyle Thompson and Miles Thompson and Randy Stotts and, you know, and Kyle Jackson. So you got, you know, a bunch of, you know, or Shane Jackson, I'm sorry. Kyle Jackson's on Rochester. You got Shane Jackson. Yeah, it's, you know, it's, you got a lot there. You got a lot going there. So this is something that they really need to start out. You know, if you put DiRusso in there, this is, like you said, this is a game that he can step up, come up huge. And it could be a little momentum builder for next weekend. It really can.
Exactly. That's,
you know, I mean, they at least play well in this game. Okay? Let's just say they play well and they lose this game 13-12. Okay? But they play great. Going into next week's game, that's got to be a big momentum boost. You know, coming at home, yeah, okay, fans are going to be upset. Oh, my God, we're 0-3. But you know what? That last game, last week, they played, you know, really good. You know, they didn't fall behind early. They didn't, you know, give up a five. You know, they weren't up down by five goals and having the battle the whole entire time. It was an up-and-back game. You know, kind of like the way Toronto played Georgia last week. You know, where it went all the way down to the very end, to the last 20-something seconds. You know, it was, you know, have it be a game like that. But who knows? You know, if I'm looking down the line, speaking fairly, I think Toronto's going to win this. But I'll be sitting on my sofa watching it on local television, WPHL 17, rooting for the Wings. No ifs, ands, or buts. Because I'd rather be wrong in this situation.
I'm right there with you. And speaking of the PHL 17, there's just so many comments about the commentary and the play-by-play.
Yeah.
I almost don't want to even bring this up, but the last week, I'm like, what is this guy watching? I didn't see the first game, so I don't know how they were, but that was a little bit embarrassing, that play-by-play. That was not good.
I mean,
I know Booker. I mean, he He's a ball worker. He's a good dude. He knows what he's doing, but I don't think he should become a play-by-play.
Who was the guy with him? I know it wasn't Gabrielson.
No, it wasn't. You know what? I can't remember his name. I know he played for Rochester, but I can't remember who. I should have looked it up because I had a feeling you were going to ask me. I don't remember who it was. Because I was surprised at that. Like, who's this guy? And then I saw the name. Like, oh, yeah, he played for the Nighthawks. So maybe that was just something they were throwing out there because they were playing Rochester or Gabrielson maybe had a commitment, couldn't make it. I don't know what that was about.
Well, the thing was, they were doing the game from the studios at the Comcast Center. At the Wells Fargo Center.
I did not know. It looked like an unfamiliar... the setting they were at, it looked like they were... I thought it was maybe as a test in the Rochester Arena.
No, they were not in the Rochester. They were actually in the Wells Fargo Arena in one of the studios broadcasting the game through the monitor.
Well, you know what? That explains a whole lot, then.
Because I asked Scotty if they were going to Rochester. And he said, no, we're doing it from the Wells Fargo Center. We're doing it from the studio.
I did not know that. When I spoke to Craig McFansky from Rochester, he indicated to me that they were coming up there.
That's not where I was.
Something may have changed.
Maybe
it
changed. I don't know.
That was 3 weeks ago when I called him for media. That was, 3 weeks. So
yeah.
Things will change, obviously.
Yeah, so who knows? But who's calling them the wingers? That's what I want to know.
That was Booker and the other guy. Whoever that other guy was. The wingers.
They're not the wingers.
Because I made that mistake on our last show. I kept saying the wingers aren't picking up the ball in the face-off. And I said, no, I don't. I mean, not the wings, the wingers. And it was funny because I'm hearing it like, is this guy listening to me? I thought they were talking about face-offs because, Baptiste wins it and Rochester gets possession, and I thought they were making out a point of, the wingers aren't picking up their men, and that was not what they were doing. They were calling the wingers.
Yeah, I mean, if they're calling the players, the forwards, the wingers, no, they're forwards. They're not wingers. This isn't ice hockey. The team is the wings. The players out on the field are forwards and defensemen. They're not wingers. You don't have a left wing. You don't have a right wing. That's hockey. Okay?
I agree.
So they're forwards. The forwards are not picking up the ball, not the wingers. This isn't ice hockey, guys. This is indoor lacrosse. You got forwards and defensemen. Okay, in the outdoor game, you got attackmen, you got middies, completely different. If I hear wingers today, I'm going off the handle.
I said it incorrectly last time we talked. I kept saying the wingers. I meant whatever it is. I meant the wing men, the guys on the wing. But it doesn't matter. If you're wrong, you're wrong. Fix it and move on. And that's what I did. I'm sorry I'm calling the wingers. That's wrong. But then this guy did the whole game he was doing it.
Yeah,
you think somebody would say, yo, man, this ain't hockey. It's like, wow.
Yeah.
And that guy's been around lacrosse for years and years. He knows that. Maybe it's because he's on television and he's got to talk, and maybe he's not thinking about what he's saying. But at some point, somebody's got to tap him on the shoulder and say, that's not right. No.
Yeah. Now, again, real quick, tonight, this is the third game in a row that the Wings will be in. I'm calling it the spotlight. Okay? The first game, they were the only game at 1 o'clock in the afternoon on a Saturday. So everybody can watch them. Okay, there's no other games around them at all. Not until 7 o'clock at night. Last week, they were the only game on Saturday night. All the other ones were played on Friday night. So again, if you want to watch lacrosse on Saturday, the only thing to watch is the Philadelphia Wings. Tonight, the same thing. They are the only game tonight on Friday night. That's it. Nobody else is playing tonight. So again, the lacrosse eyes are focusing on the Philadelphia Wings tonight and who they're playing. So they're getting a lot of exposure there because there's not like a split audience that's saying, oh, well, I'm going to switch over to this game or that game.
Which you had last Friday, you had three games at the same time. So, you said, well, let's see what score this game is. And they're switching. Now, like you said, when I watch a cross, it's a wings or nothing.
Right, it's a wings or nothing day.
You know, I'm interested to see the attendance, too, because Toronto has been steadily declining every year with attendance.
Yeah.
And I have been following that all year, and the numbers are pretty good, but now Vancouver had like 9,000, and that's, all about that. But,
well, it's better than what they had before when they were in Langley.
I've been following that real close.
Yeah, when they play in Langley, they're only averaging 3,000. So 9,000 in one game—that's three games last year.
yeah, sure. That's money making point at that point. And you know, Georgia under 5,000, but I've had people tell me they were lucky they had 500.
100, right?
Yeah.
Now the other game.
I'm only running on what the NLL gave me. That
exactly.
Was their NLL stat on their sheet.
Right.
1,008 something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But who knows?
Georgia, I don't understand the whole Georgia thing. I mean, they're just not making any money. And one of the most marketable teams in the league.
Yeah. Well, the other game...
I think they're in the last tier of the league also.
Probably, yeah. Well, the other games we have this week, you got Vancouver at Georgia. That's tomorrow night, 7:05. Rochester's at Buffalo at 7:30. And San Diego's at Saskatchewan at 8:30. And then Sunday, you got Calgary at Colorado. So, real quick, I'm obviously going to go Georgia tomorrow night, Rochester, only because I can't find myself ever rooting for Buffalo, unless I really have to. I think Saskatchewan's going to make a statement tomorrow night after losing their opening game on the road. And I think Colorado's going to beat Calgary, but that game I think is going to be a close one because Calgary always plays them tough. And like I said, tonight I just think Toronto's going to win this game. It's going to be a close one, but I'm hoping I'm wrong. I really, really am. You know, my heart's telling me yes, go Philadelphia. They're going to win it. They're going to win it. Like I would root for them every single time anyway, but going straight down the middle here. Looking at it fairly, their last two slow starts, as I said, I'm thinking Toronto is going to pull this out, and I'm hoping I'm wrong. I really, really am. I'm hoping the tables are turned, and it's the Wings that come out and start out with a 5-goal lead. You know, and it could happen. It could happen. It's just a matter.
Sure, it's all about how they come out.
Yeah.
And I kind of agree. I'm leaning on the Toronto side just because the matchups. The only advantage that Philadelphia has is the X with Baptiste. But if you're not finishing, what good is that?
Right.
And they haven't been finishing. They need to come out, make a statement early. Throw some bodies around instead of, just one guy throwing a check. Hey, hit some people, let them know you're in the building, and get in Rose's head, you have a shot. But
yeah.
I just can't.
I think if they work more to the inside, get an inside game going, it can go their way. They can't be forced to the outside. They can't be forced to the outside. They can't.
Yeah, they can't keep doing that.
No.
I can stop the ball from 35 feet away off the boards. I mean, you take what you get, but you got to start forcing something.
Yeah.
They have some big bodies, and they need to take advantage of the bodies and get inside. Get Matisse more into the action. He seems to be happy just dishing it off.
Yeah.
And what I'm really looking for, and we've been hitting on it, is not only the goalie, but somebody to say, now, give me the ball. I want to score. And they need a leader. I think somebody's going to step up tonight and become that leader.
Well, I think
it's not going to make a difference.
Yeah, I think Hickey's going to have a game. I really do.
I think Hickey's good for 4 goals.
Yeah, I mean, him and Cliche, I think, get back on track tonight. Jordan Hall gets back on track, and hopefully the goaltending holds up. I really, hope that happens.
You met those guys as well as I did. They are some big bodies.
Yes.
Cluche and Baptiste are like walking fire
plugs. Oh, my God.
Those kids are immense. They're huge. And, DeRusio, what's he, 6'5", 300?
Yep. And
you got to play like it.
And the more I see Cluche play, the more I see Jake Berge.
I think we both like that months and months ago, and probably way back when North Carolina played in the championship. That's a poor man. I call him a poor man's Jake Berge.
He is
Berge to me. It's the same player. And I think Chris needs to step up to that role.
He has
a personality. You've spoken to him several times. He's got that personality. He's a leader.
Yeah, and my interview is up on the Philadelphia Wings fan club that I had with him at the end of the last game, with him and Blaze Rudin. So both. That's why I didn't play, because it's already posted up on the Wings fan club page. So anybody can go there and listen. It's also on YouTube. Just type in Chris Cliche and it'll pop right up. I have that posted up on YouTube.
We're talking Blaze Rudin. How about maybe throw him in the net?
Indoor wise, I don't know if he can do the indoor game.
I don't think if he could, he probably would be doing it. That's those who don't play are casual fans. There's a world of difference between the box and the field. All the technique is everything is different. I'm preaching the choir with you, but there's people who are listening that say, yeah, okay, put him in.
Well, yeah, look at Matt Vince. Look at Vince. He plays goalie for the indoor game, but the outdoor game he's defense.
And that's really not that uncommon, because we've said it's two different games.
Yeah,
it comes under the heading of lacrosse, but it's like baseball and softball, and you're as an umpire, you know exactly where I'm going with that.
Yes.
It's not the same.
No, it's not. Completely different.
It's maybe some similarities, but it's a total different game as far as your technique. In softball, home run hitters generally are popping up. Baseball home run hitters. They play softball, they pop it up because they get that uppercut that doesn't get it in softball, as you know. And, same thing with outdoor and indoor. I deal with a lot of indoor lacrosse guys who played outdoor, and they tell me it's not the same. It's the technique, your stance, your posture, everything is completely different. Indoor is more reactive because the ball is coming at you so much faster. But, it is what it is.
Well, on that note, we'll go ahead. We'll end the show this week. We only got another, the game's at 7 o'clock tonight, 7:30?
I think it's 7:30.
7:30 tonight. So we got just a little bit under 3 hours before, I won't say the drop of the puck, before the face-off.
and whatever you do, leave the wingers out of it.
Yes. Yeah, that's just... We got less than 3 hours. Again, it's on WPHL 17 locally here. For those that listen that are not in the Philadelphia area, it's on BR Live. It's the only game tonight. You have the Philadelphia Wings at the Toronto Rock. Tomorrow night, Vancouver at Georgia starting at 7 Eastern time. All these times are Eastern. Vancouver at Georgia at 7:05. Rochester at Buffalo at 7:30. San Diego at Saskatchewan at 8:30. And then on Sunday at 3 o'clock, Calgary, Colorado, and I don't think a lot of people from Philly are going to be watching that game because the Eagles come on at 4:40, so unless you put one TV on one and your computer on the other, I don't know, but...
I know what I'll be watching.
Yeah.
Colorado and Calgary.
Yeah, I'll be watching both. I'll have them both going.
Yeah,
so.
I'm not the major football fan that you are.
Yeah, so if not, I'll just watch the replay of the game after and... take it from there. But.
That's the beauty of technology. You don't see it live. I'll catch it at the Eagles game.
Catch it after the Eagles game. That's it.
Yeah, as long as you stay off social media, they don't tip their hand on who won. You're good.
With the game of lacrosse, I don't care about the social media aspect of it because if I find out the score, I'm still going to watch the game to see how it got to it. So, it'd be kind of interesting. But with that being said, Kev, I want to thank you again. It was a great show. We'll be back here again next week. I'm glad everybody had a fantastic holiday. Go out, support your teams if you're in the area. If you got to take a little bit of a drive, take the drive. Go see a game. It's one of the best games you'd ever want to see. One last thing real quick. I mentioned this last night. I want to send out congratulations to a good friend of ours, Jake Elliott, who will now be doing sideline broadcasting for the Saskatchewan Rush.
I got to echo that, Jake. With the new broadcasting, the NHL, check out Jake. He is, if not the best, he's right up there.
Yeah,
he knows the game, and he broadcasts a great game. He's in my top three favorites.
Yep.
With Craig and a couple other ones. He's just so good.
Yeah,
congratulations to him for getting that.
He's going to be doing sideline reporting, and from what I understand, he's also going to be doing play-by-play on some of the road games. So that's good. I mean, he's one of the best commentators doing play-by-play out there. So tomorrow night, 8:30, Saskatchewan has their home opener, the raising of the banner. You will hear Jake Elliott doing some sideline reporting, getting some interviews from players and things like that, and you'll see what we mean. I mean, he's not going to broadcast the game, but his knowledge of the game, the questions that are going to be asked, you'll be like, wow. It'll really be something there. And you'll see the respect that he gets from the players, because you'll see smiles on the players' faces as he interviews them.
And you said the questions that he asked, and I'm going to touch on that with Buck Rocker before we sign off. But the questions that he asked very intelligent lacrosse questions without insulting his audience.
Right.
And if that doesn't make, you see some guys, it's like, look at me, I know this. And when Jake doesn't come across that way, he'll ask a very intelligent question. He'll get a smile and a grin because he'll do it with a joke or whatever. But you're going to walk away as a fan saying, "Man, that's a good question. That guy knows what he's doing."
What he's doing, yeah. And Jake does. And, like I said before, I'm glad that he's going to do that. I'm looking forward to seeing him up in Vancouver during the World Indoors, and we'll talk about that later in the season. But I just wanted to put that out there. Congratulations to Jumbo, one of the better guys in the game of lacrosse, doing play-by-play, and now he's going to be doing sideline reporting for the Saskatchewan Rush, and I know they're happy to have him in their stable. So, with that being said, again, thank you everybody for tuning in. We will see everybody here again next week for another episode. Hopefully, this one we're talking about a Wings win, and we'll be talking about the lacrosse convention, which is going to be here next weekend here in Philadelphia when they face the Georgia Swarm on Saturday night, January 20th. So, for Kevin Neibauer at LaxPhilly.com, I'm Rocco Granato from InLacrosseWeTrust.com and the Philadelphia Wings Fan Club. We'll see everybody here again next week.